Hi, I'm Jeff Jarvis, and I'm a professional musician, composer, arranger, and educator here in the United States, and I also used to be a publisher, and I'm really, really pleased to be a part of the 2020 EuropaFest. I'm presently director of jazz studies at Cal State Long Beach, California State Long Beach, that is, and the COVID epidemic prevented me from coming and visiting you in person, and I'm hoping I can do that at a future date. But for now, I hope that this video presentation that I do, in fact, presentations, we're going to do two master classes for you that'll be aired on different days. I hope that they'll be an adequate substitute for what I much rather would have done in person. What I'd like to do today is to start with a little bit about my background so that you can understand who it is that's talking to you on screen here. I come from a family of music educators, although I didn't become one myself until later on in life. My father was a band director. My mother was a elementary vocal teacher. My sisters both became elementary vocal teachers. And as I said, I didn't get the teaching bug until a little bit later, so I had a different start to my career. My dad got me started out on trumpet when I was about 8 years old. I just finished third grade, and instead of starting in school in fourth grade, he gave me a little head start over the summer. He was a trumpet player himself. And I took lessons with him, and we did exercises in the Arban's book, you know, some of the trumpet methodology throughout the summer, giving me a little head start for when I'd start in on the elementary music program at the elementary school I was going to. I continued on through the school music programs until I was about 14 years old when I got a scholarship to go to a military academy in Philadelphia called Valley Forge Military Academy. And it was a very, very fine group. All the musicians were on scholarship, and we played for a lot of great dignitaries, governors. We played for President Nixon in the White House. We did a lot of very rewarding things. It was a lot of fun. It was mostly British-style brass band music, but we did have a little dance band that we played at certain events at the academy. And it was a big band. We were playing pretty much dance band music, nothing too outrageous there. But I got a lot of great experience there and carried it with me to much later in life. After I got out of military school, I went on to Temple University for a while, and I eventually started playing professionally with pop bands around the Philadelphia area, also doing some show bands in Atlantic City, New Jersey, and eventually worked my way into becoming a studio musician for a company called Philadelphia International Records, or Philly International Records, it was actually called. And they're the people that really started the disco craze that was very popular then for dancing. And I had an opportunity to play on a lot of great records for artists such as Teddy Pendergrass, the OJs, Michael Jackson, Archie Bell and the Drells, Lou Rawls, and many, many more. There was just so many. We played sessions almost 3 to 4 times a week, and there was always a new artist. It was even so popular, the disco thing was so popular, that we were getting artists that were actually dance music artists, like Edgar Winter and people like that wanted to do a disco record. So we had a chance to play for a lot of good people. It was some of the tunes I played on were Disco Inferno, Money, 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 Love Train, and many more like that. Eventually, this led to a really great opportunity for me because, as I mentioned at the beginning of the video, I do a lot of work as a writer, and I had no formal writing experience or training, but one day we were at a session, and I can't remember who the artist was. The arranger did not show up on time with the charts, and the producers knew what type of lines that they wanted, what type of horn lines they wanted to back up this artist. And they asked the four horn players, they said, can one of you write down some lines if we sing them to you and write them out for the various instruments? And nobody raised their hand. And I already knew that the other three guys had done this before. So I raised my hand and I got to do it. And I figured, well, they're saying they're going to sing me a line. This sounds like transcribing a solo, which I'd done many times. And most of the lines were in unison. If there was harmony, it was very simple harmony. And so I set out to write by hand and on pencil and paper because there was no Sibelius or no Finale, no computer notation back in those days. And I wrote the parts out, and it worked. Well, fortunately, I had cleared the first hurdle. I didn't get found out. Nobody knew that I really didn't know how to arrange. So what I wound up doing was getting more and more assignments from the record company to write horn lines And one day they even said, hey, we're going to do something with English horn for the stylistics. Have you ever written for English horn? I said, oh, yeah. And then I went home and immediately looked up in an arranging book what key an English horn was in, so I knew how to write for it. And this is the same process that happened when they said, have you ever done any writing for strings? And so I got to write some fairly simple string lines because their formula was a lot of unison, a lot of octave unison and simple chords for these pop tunes. But this led to me becoming more and more comfortable with the instruments and being able to write for them in much more complex situations later on. So getting back to how the music was prepared, every day that I write something using computer notation software, using Sibelius, that's my personal preference, to arrange and to produce parts in readable, legible scores, I just thank my lucky stars that I have that at my disposal, because back in the day, it was a pencil and paper, staying up with a pot of coffee and trying to copy out the parts really quickly for the session the next day, because many times they would give me an assignment on a Wednesday and there was four horn players or a string section showing up the following day, and I had to write the parts, whether they were transcribed from the producer's lines or lines that I had to come up with, and I had to write out parts for the players. So it was quite a scramble. And you know, what's really funny is I always thought, gee, I wonder what it's like in the, you know, at other studios or with other companies, because this really is asking a lot of me. And I found out that once I moved out to LA, this is what happens all the time. And if you think it's bad for arrangers, think what it's like for, you know, for somebody that's writing a movie score, what it's like for the film editor, who's probably the last guy to get his hands on that film, and they're already showing previews in the theater. So, but in any case, enough talking for me for a minute here. I thought I might share a little bit of music with you. This is an excerpt from a piece that I did right after the Jacksons left Motown Records. They did a couple of albums that were recorded at Philly International Records, actually at a studio called Sigma Sound, which is where they did all of their recordings. And this is, obviously it features Michael, because even when he was singing with his brothers, he was the primary focus of the group. And this is a horn chart that I played on and wrote the chart. And I was about 24 years old when this was done. So let's give a listen to that right now. Well, a few years later, I developed a relationship with a publisher that specialized in educational jazz music. I had always, after writing all these horn parts and string parts and small horn and woodwind groups that were playing for the recording sessions back in the disco days, I had really wanted to play, you know, learn how to write a big band chart. So, of course, I did what every writer does. I wrote a big band chart that was severely overwritten. Everybody had too much stuff to do. I made the classic mistakes every writer makes, which is trying to keep everybody busy all of the time. And once I got over that and started to realize that I didn't have to provide a part for every instrument all of the time, I came up with a pretty nice funk chart that I tried to get published, and they did publish it. The name of the company was Kendor Music, or still is Kendor Music. This is the company that first published Sammy Nestico, Thad Jones, Toshiko Akiyoshi, and many, many more. Don Sobeski is another one. Well, I wrote charts for the company for several years, and then I had an opportunity to work for the company as a music editor, which was really interesting because I had never done anything like this before, but I did have some writing experience now. And what I was doing was fixing little mistakes and fixing copy work. Everything was copied by hand back then, so I was there with an electric eraser correcting a D that should have been an E note or what have you. And eventually, I got to buy into the company. I had saved up some money from the recording sessions and became a part owner. And eventually I was a partner with my stepbrother. He was doing sales and I was the CEO of the company and the music editor. And while I was there, the talent that I was able to attract to the catalog was Maria Schneider, John Fedchuk, Bob Mincer, Matt Harris, and many others. The great part about my job was that as I was looking at their charts and looking at charts from Thad Jones and from Sammy Nestico and all these great writers, I was learning more about how everything came together. I was able to grab a little bit of stylistic nuance from this writer and from that writer. And as a result, you know, it was helping me. It was basically a daily version of what my arranging students here at the university do, score study. And it was extremely valuable to me. Well, during this period, I stayed active as a trumpet player. I was very active in, you know, local things, recording sessions. I was also doing a lot of trips where I would go out and guest solo with school bands and college bands, high school bands, military bands, because I was starting to build a name as a writer. So people would have me come out and maybe conduct an honors group at what they do here in the United States, perhaps they do it in Europe as well. Each state in the United States will have what's called an all-state music convention. And they have a jazz band, a choir, a concert band, and an orchestra made up of all the best kids from that state. So I got an opportunity to start conducting some of these groups where I get to work with the students for 2 or 3 days and put on a concert. Well, I've done that in 39 out of the 50 states, so I did quite a bit of it. And I really started to enjoy teaching a great deal. This is where I finally got bit by the bug, as they say. I was able to work with students and educators, see how that whole world worked, and learn how to distill the words that were more complicated and the concepts that were more complicated that we professionals use and try to break it down to where the starting point for where an 8th grade or a 10th grade jazz student would understand it. And it was really, really rewarding. At this point, I thought it'd be nice to break things up a little bit and have you hear some music that I recorded. These were from albums I did as a leader, both in the smooth jazz and in the mainstream jazz style. The first one is mainstream. It's called Powder Blues. And then you'll hear an excerpt from an album I did called Morning Drive, and that is called Silverbird. While I was working as a publisher, I was still staying pretty active as a player, and I came out to Long Beach, where I now live. There was a convention here for the International Association of Jazz Educators, and at the time, I had gotten involved with this organization to the point where a couple of years later, I became the vice president. I was voted in as vice president, and I had a great time working with a lot of fantastic musicians, most of them very, very famous, that were coming out to play or do workshops at these conferences. I was also standing in my booth at Kendor, where we were exhibiting, showing our publications. And one day when I was standing in the booth, a gentleman came up to me and said, a friend of mine said I should come and meet you. My name is John Carnahan. I'm the director of the music program at Cal State Long Beach. And I said, oh, it's great to meet you. He said, well, have you ever had any interest in teaching? And I said, well, I've always loved teaching. He says, well, I mean full time. And I said, well, you know, I own a company. I'm pretty busy as a player and a writer. And he said, well, just think about it. And of course I did. At the time I was living in upstate New York, in Buffalo, New York, where they get a lot of snow. And I started thinking how nice it would be to live in some place that didn't have snow. And I thought about that. I thought about whether this was the type of thing that I wanted to do. And I decided that I would try to do both. And I would move to California. Of course, I had to apply for the job and be hired, but I eventually moved to California. And about 2 years later, I found out it was just a little too difficult to be a CEO of a company and also a full-time educator that was running the jazz department. So I eventually sold my interest in Kendor Music, although I continue to write for them. Also, I write for Alfred Publishing and for UNC Jazz Press at the University of Northern Colorado. They have a big catalog with great writers like Jim McNeely and people of that ilk. So I've been doing a lot of publishing work with them as well. The stuff that's a little bit more difficult than I could publish for an educational publisher. But it's been very, very rewarding teaching here. I've enjoyed myself. It's been a tremendous challenge. There's a new challenge every day as I'm working with two or three big bands, teaching, arranging, and so forth. And I get the chance to work with students like Alex Flavelle. He graduated this year, but was in our program for 4 years. And also, I had a chance to work with him in a summer camp when he was in high school. So it's been a long association. And he's the person that'll be, you'll hear playing on the examples throughout these master classes. And he's also the person that's doing all the editing of the video. So lucky to have that association with him. Right about now, I think it'd be a good idea for you to hear what I've been doing here at Cal State Long Beach. I should say what my students have been doing. And I'm going to play an excerpt from one of our CDs. We have 6 CDs out as a big band. And this is an arrangement I wrote of the Beatles hit, Eleanor Rigby. So far, I've been talking about writing for big bands and doing some writing for combos and horn sections for recording sessions. But once I got to where I was starting to feel comfortable writing for 18 to 20-piece groups, I wanted to go further, of course. And so I had an opportunity to write some string parts, which I had already done for the disco records, for some vocalists, and eventually get into writing some pops orchestra charts. And I really have enjoyed that so much because now I can bring all of these non-traditional instruments, I say non-traditional for jazz anyway, into the jazz realm. So now I could write for French horns and for percussion and all kinds of mallet instruments and woodwinds and of course the beautiful string sections. When I did sessions for the disco records, we might have as many as 12 to 16 strings in the room. But imagine the feeling it is when I'm sitting in an audience listening to one of my pops orchestra charts and I'm hearing an 85-piece orchestra play. And most recently, though, I wrote a Christmas show for the Atlanta Symphony, and the finale was a full orchestra, a big band, and 300 gospel singers behind the orchestra. And the hair on the back of my neck was standing up. It was so exciting to hear this music and to actually listen to it and go, wow, I wrote that? And I think what it is just the magic that the musicians brought to my music. Right now, I'd like you to listen to an excerpt of some of that music where we're using the strings in a big band. And this is for a singer named Joe Gransden in Atlanta, Georgia. Joe was a trumpet student of mine up in New York. And I met him when he was about 15 years old. I was in my 30s. And I could tell he had talent and he was a joy to work with. And he eventually moved to Atlanta with his family. And he started doing something that I was doing up in upstate New York, which was having a quartet and singing some tunes, playing some tunes. And then he eventually started his own big band. Well, Joe has done gigs at the Blue Note in New York now. He just about owns Atlanta musically, and he does a lot of stuff with the Atlanta Symphony, and I'd like you to hear an example of one of the arrangements I did for Joe. This is a big band and string arrangement for the hit Pure Imagination.
There's no life that I know to compare with your imagination. Living there, you'll be free if you truly wish to be.
Now I think it's time to get into some actual techniques that we can discuss, things that might help you in your jazz soloing. Whether you're a jazz player or a classical player, you need to have a command of your instrument. And once I felt that I was getting more and more comfortable with some of the aspects of playing my instrument, that was when I felt like it was time for me to start to venture into improvisation, playing jazz. The same exercises I learned in my method books, I was able to draw from that information and contribute to my jazz solos. The exercise books dealt with scales, they dealt with arpeggios in different patterns that were recurring patterns that a classical player would see frequently in their music. Well, the same thing happens in jazz. I often say that everything I know about jazz I learned in classical method books, which is very, very true, because when I hear a certain chord and figure out that that chord is a G minor chord, my fingers know where to go because I practiced a lot of G minor exercises. So recognizing these patterns and putting them into sections is something that will really help you a lot rather than thinking of large pieces of information. It also sounds a little bit predictable. If I improvise with Alex and I just start playing up and down scales in order, what I need to do is divide them or rearrange them, but I need to know what those notes are. But I rearrange them into a way that it doesn't sound as much like an exercise from a book. The way I apply these to jazz is using another technique that we'll discuss in a minute called relative pitch. When I hear somebody play a chord and then they play another chord afterwards, I have to figure out, okay, how many steps away from that am I? Is it a third? Is it a fourth? Is it a major chord? Is it a minor chord? And if I have that basic knowledge that came from the methodology, I will be able to react to what it is that I hear with my instrument. Most books present scales first. I prefer in improvisation settings, if I'm teaching in a camp or at a school, to deal with arpeggios first, because you're dealing with the notes that you know will fit the chord and all the other notes are passing tones. So what I'd like to do is give you a little example of this in a very, very simple setting. I'm going to play my C major scale, and I'm going to play it all alone, then I'm going to have Alex play it with me, playing those notes in order. Now I'm going to have Alex play with me, and he's going to play in his key. He's going to play his B flat major 7 while I play that same scale. Now what I'd like to do is just play the chord tones from that, which is what he was just playing on the piano, which is going to be all the notes that will pretty much mirror what he was playing. That chord. Now, if I was to play notes in the scale that were in between those chord tones, it would probably sound wrong, even though they're the notes in the scale. So that's why I feel arpeggios are important at first. So now what I'm going to do is play the in-between notes while he plays that chord. So that kind of sounds a little bit weird, because what I just outlined was a step up and a minor arpeggio. So it's important to know that where your chord tones are so that when you're soloing and you're going to land on a note for a long period of time, that it's going to be one of those notes that fits the chord that he's playing. I'm going to give you an example of that right now. I'm going to have Alex play in tempo a B-flat major 7 chord in my key going up a step. That's in C. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to play through the scale, but I'm not going to spend a lot of time on those in-between notes. And here we go. One, a two, a one, two, three. So what I did there was I made sure to emphasize all the chord tones and just use the notes in between to get myself to transition from one chord tone to another. And then when you do it at a certain speed, it really sounds like one continuous idea. I've been discussing how important it is to use classical methodology to contribute to our jazz skills. And just like a person that is speaking to a bunch of people making a speech, imagine making that speech without a script, having to just think of it as you go along. Well, I'm calling up information from those classical exercises to help me learn to play jazz. Let's think of it this way. Classical music has chord changes too. And I'm going to play an exercise right now that was written by the great trumpet soloist that played with the John Philip Sousa Band. His name was Herbert Lincoln Clark. And this is a very, very recognizable exercise that all trumpet players use. And I'm going to play it first the way it appears in the book. Now, if I take that same exercise, which basically was a scale and arpeggio exercise, but it just gets broken up in third intervals and so forth, and I start swinging those eighth notes a little bit, and I have Alex here play some chord changes behind it, it sounds a lot like a jazz solo, and we can see how closely related classical and jazz music is. One, two, one, two, three. Well, a few minutes ago, I mentioned a term called relative pitch. Well, that term is just the way it sounds. What happens is if you're trying to find your way to a new pitch, you relate it to the pitch you previously heard. This is a technique that classical trumpet players especially, but a lot of wind players in orchestras have to use, because a lot of the composers would use the brass in exciting parts of the piece, but there would be long periods of time when they had maybe a middle section that was more of an adagio section in sonata form, where there would be a lot of string and woodwind stuff, but not a lot for the trombones, tubas, and for the trumpets. So you might have minutes at a time go by that you don't play and then have to come in accurately on the correct note. And the only way to do that is to remember what the previous note that you played before the rest was. Well, what I have found is that relative pitch is probably the most valuable skill that I ever was able to develop to use in my improvisation. For instance, let's say I'm in a jam session, somebody calls a tune, I don't know the tune, but I go ahead and solo on it even though I don't know the melody. Well, I'm soloing on it because I can relate from one chord to another by hearing the pitch, then figuring out what type of chord it is. So I'm going to go way, way back to when my sisters and I were kids, and we were all being taught to sing by our mom. None of us had started playing an instrument yet. So she approached things the way a vocal teacher would. She was trying to teach us how to navigate to the correct pitches with our voice, since we didn't have an instrument to play, to try to zero in a little closer where that pitch would be. So she would play a little game with us, and we just thought it was a fun game, but I was really learning a very valuable skill that I use a lot in jazz. And I'm going to have Alex help me with this one. What my mom would do is she would play a middle C on the piano, and then we weren't allowed to look at the piano because even at that point I had a little bit of knowledge of keyboard geography because I was taking some piano lessons. I'm still remembering that pitch was That was my middle C. Now, Alex is going to play another note, just a totally random note, and I'm supposed to figure out what that note is. That's an A. Now, what I did was I went 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, A, C, A, and I was able to navigate to that. Play another note. That's an E flat. And what I did was I remembered where the A was and then went down to the E flat. Now, the other thing that she would do with us, and she would have us match pitches. And again, this may sound like it's a very simple concept, but again, I think this is the most valuable skill I ever learned as far as something that I could apply to jazz, but also something I could apply to non-jazz music as well. So now I'm going to see if I can take a shot in the dark and say, is that my middle C? Oh, good. Thank God I did it right. All right. Now what's going to happen is Alex is going to play notes, and I'm going to try to navigate from those pitches and use, the previous pitch to get to the next pitch. Okay? Any note you want. So now I was able to find myself intervallically from note to note. Intervallically meaning I try to determine, is it a third? Is it a fourth? Is it four steps away from the last note that I played? Now let's take it one step further and how we could apply this to jazz. Again, I'm back at that jam session. The sax player who knows a million tunes and Jeff who doesn't know as many says, oh man, I don't know that tune, but go ahead, play it anyway. And I wait for him to play the melody. He plays a solo. Now it comes my turn to play a solo. And I'm going to have Alex play some random chords. And what I'm going to do is use that relative pitch to get from one starting note to another. Then I have to decide, okay, is it a major chord? Is it a minor chord? A diminished chord? An augmented chord? Is it a chord with alterations like a sharp 9 or a sharp 11? And then try to see if I can solo to those chords. Let's see. I was trying to see if I could remember my middle C, but I'm going to have you play it again. I was close. I would have missed it by a half step. Okay, so anyway, he's going to start playing chords. I'm remembering where that C is, and I'm going to use that to relate to the starting point of the next chord that he plays. So basically, I was just trying to figure my way to my next starting point, like I said, and then by ear, determine is it major, minor, as we mentioned, all the different chord types. And another part of this, too, is from hearing those chords enough times, I react to it a little bit quicker. I'm really not using music theory to get me from one place to another because it takes too long to think about that. Music theory is something, this is the thing that I tell my students here at the university. If you start with theory, then your solos are going to sound very mechanical. If you start more organically and learn how to solo by ear, then use the theory to put a name to it or to analyze it, it works a lot better. Everyone needs a point of entry into jazz, and for me, it was listening. It was a part of my sphere of influence because my parents listened to the music a lot around the house. I had no idea that I was going to become interested in jazz as a player because I thought I would be like my dad. I was going to play trumpet in bands and become a band director, and I just wanted to be like him. He was my hero, and I wanted to play with that beautiful sound that he had, although he was not a jazz player. But the reason they played it around the house was because that was the pop music of the day for them. My dad and mom both listened to and danced to music that had a swing beat to it. And so it wasn't uncommon for me to get up in the morning and hear my mom playing what became later known as vocal jazz. It was a group called the Hi-Los, which later became Singers Unlimited. Or my dad would be listening to a Count Basie record and so on. So it never occurred to me how this was going to help me later on. And what I realized after becoming a teacher and a clinician was that the one thing that young people struggle with more than anything is trying to develop a swing style. And you'll hear students play something along this line. They're playing in a very stiff way, and the reason they're doing that is because they haven't listened to the swing style played properly. Well, I heard it the whole time I was growing up, so when it came time for me to just be messing around in my bedroom when I was practicing my trumpet and I wanted to play something that was a little jazzy, my swing style was very comfortable because I had heard it a lot. A lot of the students nowadays are learning jazz in a vacuum, because they may be listening to a totally different type of music than coming into the jazz band rehearsal at school. And what are they going to do? They're going to do the thing that we all do naturally. Think about when we were kids. We're learning to speak. My mom didn't hand me a dictionary. I heard my parents talking, and I started to mimic words. I started to imitate. Well, if students aren't listening to jazz, then they'll come to their band rehearsal, and they'll imitate each other. And then you have the student dialect of jazz that has kind of a funny, stiff swing style like I played. So my point of entry now that I had the stylistic thing under my belt was I didn't know anything about theory. I didn't know anything about chords or what scales go to what chords. What I did was I played the melody. In fact, I'll demonstrate that now. I'm going to play, this is one of the first tunes I remember playing, because my mom used to sing around the house a lot because she loved Frank Sinatra, and it was Fly Me to the Moon. Now, that was somewhat swing-oriented, but it was still pretty stiff. So let's think of what we're going to do to make that sound a little cooler. We're going to put little ornaments on that melody, just like you were decorating a Christmas tree and you put ornaments on it to make it more colorful and prettier. And what I'll do is I'll start adding little grace notes or notes, little figures, or connecting notes between two notes, two chord tones, to make it sound like it's a little bit more improvised. So now I just, you still hear the melody in there, but I'm starting to jazz it up a little bit, if you'll excuse the term. Now, what happens is if you keep doing this and keep doing this, eventually what happens is you lose that melody, and you're creating ideas that fit that melody. And as I create those ideas, I'm actually improvising now, and I've strayed so far from the melody that you can still hear the chords, and if you sang the melody while I was playing the solo, you would be able to figure out that it's Fly Me to the Moon. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to play this with Alex, and what we'll do is I'll play it as a fairly straight melody, then I'll start to get a little more adventurous, until I'm eventually improvising. And you already know what key we're in, right? Okay, good. One, a two, a one, two. So you could hear as I was playing, I started to build up a little bit more confidence, stray a little bit further from the melody, and I was able to, by the end, it was a completely improvised solo. Obviously, this is not going to happen as quickly as you're learning it, but this was the process that transpired over a period of time as I built up my confidence. I was like any young trumpet player. I was nervous about it, but, you know, I was in my bedroom. Nobody's listening, you know, so I could be comfortable and learn at my own pace. Now, so far, we haven't talked about anything super, super technical, anything theoretical, because I'm trying to stress the organic part of improvisation. I think that serves us as teachers. It serves us as players, no matter how advanced you are. And, here's one example. I was watching an improvisation clinic that a friend of mine here in the States, Randy Brecker, he was doing this at a music education conference. And when he got to the question and answer portion at the end of his clinic, somebody asked him, Randy, what do you think about when you're playing a solo? Now, let's remember, Randy's solos are very complex. His writing is very complex. It has a nice groove to it. And he's a very, very respected player, as you know. And Randy's answer, they were waiting for some hyper-technical, you know, elixir of perfection that was going to make their solos sound better. Randy said, I think about the melody. And that really, you know, I love the fact that he said something that simple. The guy that asked the question looked almost disappointed that he didn't get some newfangled way to look at improvisation. But seriously, as complex as your ideas get during a solo, the best way to keep your place is to have that melody going on in your head. Even though it sounds like there, you know, your brain is having to be split in two directions, hearing the melody, thinking of ideas. But I think one of the advantages that older players have is that there was no play-along records when we were kids. So when I wanted to improvise to a recording, I was improvising while the other guy on the recording was improvising, and I had to tune that out and play my own ideas. But somehow his ideas got in there, and so I was doing kind of a transcription by ear. Some of his ideas were affecting my ideas, so that helped me out a lot. Well, one of the things that I've thought would help players that were working on improvisation, much in the same way that in big band charts written for educational purposes, you'll find a written solo in case the improviser isn't really comfortable with doing that yet and needs a little launching pad. Sometimes those written solos, even though it's easy to lean on them instead of actually improvising, they can show the player what some good ideas sound like. Well, I thought, why not take that one step further? And I wrote a couple of etude books with another trumpet player down in New York named Mike Carubia. And what I did was what we did is we wrote what they call contrafacts. A contrafact is an alternate melody that goes with the chord changes of a song. And then we gave them different titles. So, for instance, I'd like to play one of the tunes out of my etude book that is called You're the Last One, and it's based on the changes to There'll Never Be Another You. And you'll hear the changes from that tune, but you'll hear a new melody. And this would give you some of the vocabulary that would familiarize you with the sounds that would fit those chords. So we'll do this. I'll do this with Alex right now. Here we go. One, two, a one. And that etude goes on for another chorus, but I just thought playing a little bit of it would suffice for the demonstration. Well, one of the things that I haven't talked about yet is the fact that after you've done all this work and you've learned all these new skills, is when do I get to do it in front of people? Well, I hadn't really considered that when I was learning it because I had visions of playing, you know, jazz before an audience at one point. But one time I was, I did a lot of playing outside of school. I was in a group called the Community Music School Orchestra. It was sponsored by the University of Buffalo. And I was, it was playing classical music, and I was, you know, really nervous when I went into these rehearsals because it was an excellent conductor, and it was mostly college students, and I was a ninth grader in high school, or, you know, ninth grade was in the high school back in those days. Now it's part of the junior high. But, and I was, you know, having to transpose trumpet parts. I didn't even own a C trumpet, which you'd use a lot in classical music. Well, there was a clarinet player in the Community Music School Orchestra that heard me practicing. I was playing Fly Me to the Moon, ironically. And he asked me if I was interested in jazz, and I said, oh, yeah, I really like it. I'm trying to learn how to play it, but, you know, I don't know how I'd ever go about getting to play it publicly. And he says, well, I have an idea. There's a place called the Pine Grill in downtown Buffalo, and there's a lot of famous people that come through there, but part of their contract is they do a jam session on Sunday afternoons from 2 to 5. Why don't you come on down? And I said, well, you know, why not? You know, and of course, I was terribly nervous. But I went down, and I was looking at some of the pictures in the Pine Grill, and it's no longer there, but they have an annual Pine Grill reunion all these years later. I think it closed down 30 years ago. But in any case, people like George Benson, Johnny Lytle, Jimmy McGriff, Brother Jack McDuff, all these famous jazz players were coming through there. And the week that I went down there, Jimmy McGriff was the organist. Jimmy McGriff was playing, and he started off some tunes, and people would come up and sit in. And the guy that invited me down there, he came up with an alto saxophone, not a clarinet. And I was thinking, wow, he plays two instruments. And he played, and he sounded great. And I was really, really nervous. And I just played. In fact, I think here we go again. I think I asked him to play "Fly Me to the Moon," and they did, because it was one of the two tunes I think I knew at the time. And lo and behold, I finished my solo, and the people applauded. And that was all it took. That was all the encouragement I needed to keep on going. So I kept going down to the Pine Grill every Sunday, and I had a great education doing that. By the way, the clarinet player that invited me down to the Pine Grill, his name was Grover Washington Jr. And he went on to, you know, do some, what they didn't have a term for it back then, but it was kind of like smooth jazz. He was doing a lot of Marvin Gaye tunes, and he had a beautiful style, but he was a real Duke Ellington fan. And what a wonderful, wonderful player. He's gone now, but I hope he's up there listening to me talk about him right now, because he had a tremendous impact on the beginning of my jazz life. Well, it looks like we've come to the end of our time for this first masterclass, but there's another one coming, so stay tuned. I will continue to share experiences and techniques that hopefully will help your playing and your teaching. I know that a lot of the people that are part of the EuropaFest are primarily performers. However, even if you decide you don't want to be a teacher, you're going to be asked to teach at some point in time. A lot of times when people ask you to come to do an appearance, they may want you to do a workshop as a part of it, or maybe it's your guest soloing with a pops orchestra, but they have a youth element to it. So they say, hey, part of your contract is you'll come in the afternoon and do a one-hour masterclass for some students. So in one point or another, you might be asked to teach. So some of these techniques, even though they may seem like they're very basic, sometimes even as professionals and as expert players, we need to get back to basics if we notice there's a flaw in our playing. We'll talk about that a little bit in the second masterclass. But again, my pleasure to be here for the 2020 EuropaFest, and I hope that this information is valuable, and I look forward to meeting all of you in person.